Martin Luther King Jr. were alive today, wonder what he would think about what's going on in this world right now. I'm Deidre Malone. We'll have that dialogue when we come back. You're watching Dialogue with Deidre.
Inciting large-scale arrests and sympathy marches.
I'm very aware of that, Mr. Hoover.
What I do know is he's nonviolent.
What I need to know right now, what's Martin Luther King about to do next?
Mr. President, Dr. King is here.
Mr. President, in the South, there have been thousands of racially motivated murders.
We need your help,
Dr. King. This thing's just going to have to wait.
It cannot wait.
You got one big issue, I got 101.
Selma it is.
Here is the next great battle.
Selma's the place, and they ready.
Dr. King!
I tell you, that white boy can hit.
You will not tolerate agitators attempting to orchestrate a disturbance in this state.
It is unacceptable that they use their power to keep us voiceless.
People actually say they're gonna kill our children. They're trying to get inside of your head.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
We build the path as we came, rock by rock.
His cell is probably bugged.
It probably is.
We must march. We must stand up.
You march those people into rural Alabama, it's gotta be open season.
May I have a word?
There's no word to be had.
The people! The people! The people! The people! The people!
There are 70 million people watching.
These pictures are going around the world.
We must make a massive demonstration.
White, black, and otherwise. Come to Selma.
I heard about the attack of innocent people. I couldn't just stand by.
Looks like an army out there.
This revolution goes on and on. This revolution goes on and on.
My eyes have seen the glory. 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 Hallelujah.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
Wow, Teller Brown, your drugstore, your drugstore, and your drugstore. Hey, we everyone's drugstore. And we're located at 3333 East Chevy Drive, 794-3690. All medical plans. We support supported living, assisted living. We do it all. And guess what? We even have a $4 plan. Hey, call to ask Dr. Brown about that. I gotta go because she's coming with those boots.
The Carter Malone Group is a full-service public relations agency. Celebrating 10 years of being in business, the Carter Malone Group is located in Midtown Memphis and represents clients across the country. No matter what size your business, if you are interested in promoting your product or service and increasing your market share, contact the firm that can help you meet your goals. The Carter Malone Group. Call 901-278-0881 today.
Thank you.
Dialogue with Deidre. I'm your host, Deidre Malone. In the studio with me today is Mr. Rabia Lewis Haynes. Welcome to Dialogue with Deidre.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here having dialogue with Deidre.
I'm so glad you're here. And we're excited to hear more about your play. If Dr. Martin Luther King were alive today, it's a one-man play. And you wrote it, right?
Yes.
Produced it?
Yes, I produced it, but I just don't fancy that term.
Okay, produced. Tell me the term you fancy. No,
I mean, you know, the credits would be writing it,
uh-huh,
performing it,
okay,
performing. And directing it.
Oh.
I mean, the term producer to me is a person that has an abundance of things, and we're not on that level. Just don't welcome the term producer.
Let me just say, as someone who has produced, I really think that fits that category. I think you are a producer as well.
Well, I welcome the term. I welcome the term. Just not ready to use it yet personally myself.
Okay. Well, let's talk about what motivated you to write and act.
Oh, we're going way back.
We now. Are.
Well, I'll tell you, concerning Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I'd have to give credit to my mother. Because, you know, I grew up and born and raised in the projects, the
Which
Robert projects in Chicago.
Oh, I'm from Chicago, too.
Yeah, you know, very, very hostile environment at times, you know. As a child, you know, I'm talking about maybe 8, 9, 10 years old, 11 years old. I was 13 when Dr. King departed from us. I was 13.
Mm-hmm.
But in those days, you used to, you know, we used to high-rise buildings, and as kids, we used to go out and then come in just to eat. And my mother had these saying, all y'all do is just run out. All y'all come in is to eat something else and something else. I think y'all get a gist of what I'm
right,
talking about.
Right, exactly.
You know, that's all y'all do. That's all you run in and out of the house, run in and out of the house. You know, if it ain't for eating or something like that, use the bathroom, da 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 da.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I don't see you. But then, if Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s voice was on the radio or the television or anything, I would freeze. I would stay in the house. And my mother was amazed at that, that was the only thing that seemed to keep me in the house. You know, so I would have to say that was the first inclination of me of thinking about Dr. Martin Luther King or wanting to do anything to contribute to his footsteps or wanting to even say, hey, maybe I could write. You know, I see people that can do that. You know, we needed images in those days of people doing things to believe we could.
Exactly. So
yeah.
He's had a profound impact on your life.
He has. So, I mean, I couldn't see it coming.
Okay. So talk to me about your process for writing.
Well, the process for writing then took place, and you know you have to go get some professionalism and let somebody coach you and these type mm-hmm. of things. So I went to early, I was, say, maybe 20. I was 20, latter half of 19 or 20, and I went to Lawrence Merrick Drama College, and I thought I was just going there to be an actor. But you had to do everything there.
Okay.
You had to learn how to write. You had to learn how to direct. You had to learn how to film. It was actually film school, entertainment school.
Where is that located?
That was, I remember the address very well. It was 870 North Vine in Hollywood, California.
Okay.
Yeah. And so that's when writing really began to take form, because a lot of times when you write things, everyone thinks what they write is excellent, it's good. You know,
right.
I wrote it. It looks good to you. But can you lift those words off of the paper and convey them to even just one additional person,
right?
And get your message across is the challenge.
What made you want to do a one man play?
So no one can ever, can I say ever? One more time.
One more time. You got the floor.
Quit on me.
Okay.
I've been with many theater groups, you know, musicals, big musicals. I used to tour with Smokey Robinson and Mickey Stevenson. I was their technical director all the way from Los Angeles to New York.
I heard that even in film school, was it Terrence, the big film director, was in your class? Was it Terrence?
No, that was a film school that I did in New York. It's a temporary, short-term film school.
Mm-hmm.
And what I was trying to convey is I was also a student with Will Smith and Quentin Tarantino.
Oh, Quentin Tarantino.
Not
that's
at the
him.
Same time, but we had the same instructor. He's the same instructor.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We all had the same instructor. You know, Will and Quentin got their start from Dove Simmons.
Okay.
And
so you guys learned from somebody that was probably really talented.
Yeah, he's good at what he do.
Okay.
You know, he's very good at what he do, and I think that's teaching others. Not that he can do it himself. I don't think he can step out there like Quentin Tarantino and do what Quentin Tarantino do. But he had that ability to teach you how to do what Quentin Tarantino do.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
So talk to me about, I don't want to give too much of the play away because we want people to actually buy tickets, okay? We want people to buy tickets and actually come see the play. But talk to us a little bit about the play, just a brief synopsis.
Well, you know, many times, and I saw Samuel Jackson on Broadway with The Mountaintop and with Angela Bassett. And I've talked and heard some of the things that Denzel said about trying to play Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And they all said the same thing, that the energy level is so high, it's hard to do, it's very difficult to stay in the shoes of that man. He's just so clairvoyant. I mean, it's, you know, they deem it almost impossible, but challenging for their careers. And so from listening at some of these things of the past of some of those people, including Paul Winfield, portrayed Dr. Martin Luther King in various times and spaces in the past, you come to terms with, well, how was it received? And you find out, as you study and dig a little deep, you find out that, you know, they say, he's too short. He was too fat. He too tall. He too light. He too dark. Too old, too young, something. They find something wrong with you to, you know, trying to walk in the footsteps of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So it's difficult.
Perfect. Right, right.
It's difficult. So the approach I take is I don't play Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Okay.
I play a character called Bobby. He admires Dr. King so immensely that when he finds himself in situations, whether it's facing jail or any other adversity, he remembers the words of Dr. King and he transforms into Dr. King.
Okay.
Right before your eyes on stage.
Okay.
And we're talking about, you know, it's a one-man show. So a lot of times you get bored looking at one man unless some dynamic is happening.
So you're making some dynamic things happen as a part of this play.
Yes. It's not a keynote speaker standing up on stage just delivering
just
some
like
speeches.
A little monologue. So
no.
You are really into it.
Yes, we're performing.
Okay.
And when I say we, I include
you're in characters.
I include the audience.
Okay, that's good. That's really
good. We're having
good.
A good time, and we're reliving some of the words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and mostly the famous ones, the ones that we know. But I bring to light some other things that I think some may or may not know.
What do you want people to be able to take away from
good
the
question.
Play?
Good question. I had this question posed to me once before, and you know, there's so many things that I want them to take away from it, but I know we don't have time for all those things.
Just give me one
so
good nugget.
I want the children or the youth to be able to not just participate, but walk away and become an advocate for King and keep the dream alive and say, hey, that was interesting enough to make, I didn't know this, I didn't know that. That makes me want to fulfill that. That's what I want them to walk away with. Forget about me, you know. But, you know, like as Jesus would say, not me, but my Father.
Right.
Who done so, you know. Dr. King would say, not me, but through the Spirit of Jesus, you know. And so I say, not me, but through the spirit of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Okay. So you want them to take away a spirit of equality that, you know, every man, woman should have a right to health care, home, good quality job.
I touch base on that.
Okay.
Healthcare. You know, I touch base on the health care issue that as it pertains to President Obama, you know. I don't want to give too much.
Okay, I don't. No, no, no. So let me just ask you this question then, Mr. Haynes. If Dr. King were alive today, he'd be about 86 years old. He'd be celebrating his birthday, the same birthday as my husband, the 15th.
1929.
Yeah. So what do you think he'd think about the state of affairs today?
Well, this question was also posed to me once before. And I feel that Dr. Martin Luther King done so many wonderful works for us. You know, he took out of his time to do these things, to address issues that he knew needed to be addressed. You know, it's like an ideal. His work is an ideal that goes on and live even after the brain that created it has gone to the dust, right? And so in saying that, the best way that I could put this, because it's a very delicate place for me, but Dr. King, the essence of Dr. King, with you know, it's like I want to say love, but I don't want to give the total play away.
No, don't
I'm
do
not,
it.
I'm not stuck right here, but what I am is I want to give you enough to know where I'm trying to go with this, and at the same time feel like you still have some more to come and get. So we don't want to give it away, but I think he would talk about love. I think that would be the essence of what really matters today.
Okay.
That would be, you know, because he done Trumpet of Conscience during the Vietnam War, Peace on Earth, Goodwill Toward All Men.
That's right.
I Have a Dream. He did a letter. He wrote a letter to us from Birmingham City Jail. It wasn't really to us. He addressed it to clergymen that attacked his profile of being unwise and untimely as it pertains to going to Birmingham, Alabama and protesting, you know, but he had done everything he could do concerning the there's four basic steps to nonviolence: collection of the facts to determine whether the injustice are a lie, negotiations, purification, is self-purification rather, and direct action. So now we had come to the point where it was direct action only. That was all he can do. And these five clergymen, liberal clergymen, you know, kind of took him away from his work. He rarely responded to any criticism of his work. But this letter he wrote, he addressed it to those clergymen, and we are privy to it. During the Birmingham City Jail letter that he wrote, which was never public. And this letter would kind of put you in the place where it lets you know how you would want to ride the coattail of Dr. King and continue his work, continue his idea, continue to be a part of that big idea that never dies.
Never dies.
Hopefully, I'm contributing my part to the dream. And it's a very sensitive place for me.
Well, it sounds like it, and I'm excited to share with people the fact that the play is going to open here in Collierville at the Harrell Performing Arts Center. Tickets are available now. And you're not going to want to, I mean, you're going to want to see this. You're not going to want to miss it. And so it's opening on Thursday, January 29th.
That's correct.
And it's running through Sunday, February the 8th.
Right. But we're talking weekends only. We're talking long weekends, though, Thursday, Sunday,
Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
And then a repeat of Thursday, Friday, Sunday,
and
which would be 5th through 8th and 29th of January through February 1st.
And it's going to be a good play for students, for adults, seniors, all ages. And what we're going to do before this show wraps up is we're going to make sure that we put on the screen where people can get tickets. And if you need any additional information on the play, you can actually call the Carter Malone Group at 901-278-0881 for ticket information. We'd be more than happy to share that with you. And we're also going to give you information on how you can buy tickets online as a part of this show. Before we wrap up our interview, Mr. Haynes, I'd like to ask you, what do you think about the upcoming movie, Selma, that's going to drop? It's going to be premiere here in Memphis.
Well,
actually tomorrow.
You know, I'm excited to see it myself. I want to see what, you know, what it embodies, you know, as it pertains to some of the information that I know of about Selma, you know, the behind the Selma March.
Right.
You know, behind the Selma March, I believe it was some days between 1965, between from January it began up until February 6th, I believe it was.
So you like a civil rights history buff? I mean, you're
not necessarily a civil rights history buff.
But what would you call yourself then, when it comes to
a hungry?
Okay.
A hungry, determined individual to take the shutters and the blinders off, that I may be able to walk freely, think freely, you know, all of the time, you know, like dissolve that compartmentalization that separates the ego from the essence of love that's within the man. And the only way to do that is to get appropriate facts and information that helps you to, you know, truthful. Then when we're talking facts, that helps you to, you know, they said truth will make you free.
Right.
So this is the only way we can become free. So I just kind of like, I'm just hungry for the information. So there's so much that yet I still don't know.
And do you believe that history, knowing your history, allows you, if you have any sense, not to repeat it, especially if it's something that has, you know, had a negative impact on your people?
Well, that's a different area. Now we're talking the psychological area. We're talking about an area of clinical and all of that type of stuff that says that, you know, everything has a faith. You can have faith in a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and evidence of things unseen.
Exactly.
And this type of thing, you know, it's a lot of different ways to describe faith. So does the negative 101 forms of fears and desires of man that comes in and bombards you at times and enters in subliminally. Well, you can, it's almost impossible to eliminate, since you can't detect them. They germinate, they hide. So what you find yourself doing is repeating things over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
Like the criminology say, if you come in contact with crime, you endure it.
Huh.
And then you stay in contact with it long enough, you become accustomed by it. And before you know it, you become influenced by it.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're acting out on it.
Huh.
So it's a whole new different area when y'all talk about, you know, if you could just take the information alone itself and put it on and say, oh, okay, this is going to help me to not, you know, I know my history now. This is going to help me to not repeat some things that I've done in the past. Not so. Still a whole lot of work to do. A
lot of work to do.
Yeah.
Okay.
Still a whole lot of work to do, because it's just it could be a simple thing as smoking a cigarette. What do you, can your past or your history tell you? It tells you that the cigarettes cause cancer, you know. But will you still continue to pick one up?
That is an excellent point. I hadn't even thought about it like
will
that.
Will you still continue to pick
some
one up?
Some people will.
You see what
some
I mean?
Some people will.
Now, for
will.
Those of us who don't smoke, it seems like, you know, hey, you could just quit, but it's not that easy.
It's not.
It's not that simple.
You know, I guess,
you
know,
it's not that simple. So we can't point the finger at nobody.
Right.
We can't point the finger at nobody for nothing that they do. Best thing we could do, and the best thing I try to do, is eliminate those causes which keep me down, which holds me down, which cause me to be negatively influenced by something that I know is not a good regimen for my body, mind, and spirit.
Well, let me just say that I so appreciate you being on Dialogue with Deidre today. And when you're back in town, we want to have you come on back on, okay?
I'd love to come.
All right, yeah. So you've been watching Dialogue with Deidre. We'll be back in a moment. Mr. Rabia Haynes is Our guest was our guest this first half hour of the show, and his play, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Were Alive Today. If Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Were Alive Today, it starts on January the 29th. But call 901-278-0881 for additional information. We'll be back in a moment.
First time I felt it was easy money. I used what I had to for school books, and after whatever was left, you know, I didn't realize it wasn't gonna last long. So, you know, at 18 years old, you're out there, okay, free money, shopping, purses, new shoes. I didn't think about the consequences later.
The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau estimates that we have about $1.2 trillion in student loan debt in America.
There are plenty of people who take out loans. You know, it's very, very common. So it didn't bother me that I had to do it.
So we would go around and we would give presentations. I did a previous documentary, State of the Black College Student, where we talked about various issues. And one small feature of it was student loan debt. However, what we found is that everybody across demographics wanted to talk about student loan debt because it didn't matter if you were black or white, male or female, young or old, everybody was dealing with this student loan debt issue. So the student loan debt issue was ubiquitous. It was everywhere. Everybody wanted to talk about it. And so we decided we have to address this issue because it has become the issue of our time.
I always said, if I didn't get a scholarship, I was gonna see Uncle Sam. That's what I was gonna do. My sister said, why not get a loan? Don't worry about it. Just, you're gonna get a job. You're gonna be able to pay it back. That's how we thought. But no one really knows how it feels to pay something back at 17, 18, 19, 20 years old.
Oh yes, it was free money. It was pretty much, you know, you can get a student loan and then you won't have to worry about working and you can get an apartment on campus if you take out a student loan.
This is not free money. Okay, there's an American myth that allows us to feel like because it's easy money, it's free money. This is not free money.
Like, Sally will find you. That's not like having an ex-wife or anything. Like, it's much worse. She is going to get 100.
I run credits for apartment complexes because you have to meet credit-wise, and I'm not lying to you about it. More than 80% of the people that I run have student loans, and most of them are in collections.
It sounds great, $1.20, $1.87, $200, $250 a month on a $45,000 loan. That's really, if you look at how much is going towards interest, and that you're not paying that till you're ready to retire.
When you get a student loan, they can give you so many thousands of dollars a semester if you don't have somebody to tell you, take it easy, don't get all that. I've watched people get $3,000 and $4,000.
Everybody else is doing it. I'm telling you something that you have not heard before because we are in a crisis situation. You must make better decisions financially, and you need information, and this is the information that you need.
Wow, Teller Brown, your drugstore, your drugstore, and your drugstore. Hey, we everyone's drugstore. And we're located at 3333 East Chevy Drive, 794-3690. All medical plans. We support supported living, assisted living. We do it all. And guess what? We even have a $4 plan. Hey, call to ask Dr. Brown about that. I gotta go because she's coming with those boots.
The Carter Malone Group is a full-service public relations agency. Celebrating 10 years of being in business, the Carter Malone Group is located in Midtown Memphis and represents clients across the country. No matter what size your business, if you are interested in promoting your product or service and increasing your market share, contact the firm that can help you meet your goals. The Carter Malone Group. Call 901-278-0881 today.
Got supporters. Detroit, New York, Los Angeles, inciting large-scale arrests and sympathy marches.
I'm very aware of that, Mr.
Hoover.
What I do know is he's nonviolent. What I need to know right now, what's Martin Luther King about to do next?
Mr. President, Dr. King is here.
Mr. President, in the South, there have been thousands of racially motivated murders.
We need your help, Dr. King. This thing's just gonna have to wait.
It cannot wait.
You got one big issue, I got 101.
Summer it is.
Here is the next great battle.
Selma's the place, and they ready.
Dr. King!
I tell you, that white boy can hit.
You will not tolerate agitators attempting to orchestrate a disturbance in this state.
It is unacceptable that they use their power to keep us voiceless. Those that have gone before us say no more.
People actually say they're gonna kill our children. They are trying to get inside of your head.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
We built the path as we came, rock by rock.
His cell is probably bugged.
It probably is.
We must march. We must stand up.
You march those people into rural Alabama, it's got to be open season.
May I have a word?
There's no word to be had.
The people. The people. The people. The people. The people.
There are 70 million people watching. These pictures are going around the world.
We must make a massive demonstration.
White, black, and otherwise. Come to Selma.
I heard about the attack of innocent people. I couldn't just stand by.
Looks like an army out there.
This revolution goes on and on. This revolution goes on and on.
My eyes have seen the glory. 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 Hallelujah.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
Welcome back to Dialogue with Deidre. I'm your host, Deidre Malone. This is a hot ticket. You need to know about it. If you don't, the colored girls are presenting the movie Selma here in Memphis, Tennessee. The premiere is tomorrow night, and only the colored girls, with a little help from the chairman of the city council, Myron Lowry, could get the mayor of Selma, Alabama, here to Memphis, yes. Tennessee. Welcome, Mayor Evans.
Welcome. I am glad to be here. Glad that Myron talked me into it, as well as Mary, and of course, not to Gale. They twisted my arm in terms of coming to Memphis. However, I've been here a lot of times.
But, you have?
This is on a different occasion and a most historical time. So I'm glad to be in the historical city of Memphis, Tennessee.
Let's talk about history. I mean, okay. You're the mayor of a very historic city, specifically when it comes to the civil rights movement. And a movie that's going to premiere here in Memphis tomorrow night, Selma, I'm hearing from a little birdie that you and your wife are actually in that movie.
Yes, we were fortunate enough to be asked by Ava DuVernay, who's one of the directors and producers, and of course with Oprah Winfrey, Ms. Winfrey, asking that we be, you know, be part in the movie. We don't have a speaking part. We're actually in many of the marching parts in that movie, and certainly it was a new experience for me, and an exciting experience to be there and to meet all the cast and to have times to just dialogue with them, as well as have the experience of sitting down with Ms. Winfrey and talk about a lot of things, because she stayed in Selma.
She did?
There's 3 nights in Selma there at one of the homes that was able to obtain for her and her cast to come and have their meetings and dinner and things like that. So it was a great experience.
So what do you think this movie is going to do for your city?
It's no doubt in my mind it's going to bring about more tourism. It'll bring about more interest and talk and concern. There are probably so many people who lived in Selma years ago who no longer live there, or maybe somewhere else at this point, probably never identified with saying, I am from Selma. But now everybody's from Selma, so because of all the publicity of God. But I think that it'll tremendously have a lot of impact in tourist dollar and visitation and things like that that will come to Selma over a period of time.
I'm sure. And what in terms of the cast and crew being there, was it a little economic boom?
Yes, no doubt.
Selma?
They stayed there at the hotels. They spent money there. They bought up everything they could buy in Selma in terms of things like that. So it was an economic tax hike in Selma while they was there, and we look forward to them coming back again.
What do you think the difference is today, like 50 years later, from that march?
Well,
from your city now to today.
Well, I think it's a tremendous difference. Selma is no longer Selma from the standpoint of 1965. There has been a lot of changes in Selma. There are a lot of attitude adjustments and changes in Selma. You know, in the city, there are still people who have drama.
Yes, and they do.
They won't go away. They still really relive that history often. But at the end of the day, the citizens of Selma as a whole are working together, getting along, wanting to move forward in spite of all the drama, as well as the fact that some of them want to forget that history.
Right.
But that history, as I've said to other places, the history is history, and we should never forget our history. And I'll tell our young people who so seem to forget so quickly about our history and not recognize and identify with the fact that there are people who lost their lives,
yes,
who gave up their bodies for whatever reason may be, and as a result of that, we've come where we are. We've come because of the fact that those persons who walked that bridge and those highways in 65 made it possible we may have certain freedoms we have today and rights that we have today that sometimes we still don't take advantage of.
You know, what's really disturbing to me is that young folk, you know, a lot of them don't understand that. And I think it's incumbent upon us for us to try and educate them so they can get it. Because when you think about the people that died for the right for us to have an opportunity to vote, to live where we want to eat in restaurants that we want to, and we don't take advantage, specifically a lot of African Americans or minorities, we don't. What do you think, Mayor, we can do about that?
Well, it's a conversation that we must always have, and I think that this not only needs to be done in the schools, but in the churches as well, and in the homes. I think that's important. That's where a lot of things begin, in the home anyway, and many of our homes are separated because of one family, father, mom, and thing like that. But I guess a combination of school, church, and home has to be the nucleus by which we still get our young people to realize how important it is that they go out and vote. They go out and get a skilled job.
That's right.
And things like that, and not sit around and want someone to give them something rather than earn it. And so that's a hard task. That's truly a hard task because there's so many obstacles out there, so many other things they can do and choices that you and I didn't have. We came up.
That's right.
We didn't have those freedoms to do certain things. We had to earn what we've got.
We sure did.
And nowadays things come so easy and so free sometimes. And as a result of that, we just don't work hard to get it sometimes, nor do we. You see, I think in many ways, it's better to have an opportunity and be prepared than to have opportunity and not be prepared. And that's what's happening in a lot of our situation now. that our young people are not prepared for the skill level jobs that's out there, and wonder why they don't get the job. But it's about skills now.
It is.
And education and things like that, and knowing how to read and so forth and so on. And that's the key to it all. And so I just think that between the church, the school, and the home, we're going to do a better job of educating our young people. And I say this to them, that we can never forget our history.
That's right.
Our young people need to always know our history. And I've said also that we should never get it, but we don't necessarily want to go and get even. But,
exactly.
But the fact is, we need to remember it.
And let's move forward.
And move forward. Pardon.
Mayor Evans, you know, it's so appropriate, I think, that Selma is being premiered in the month of January. Dr. King's birthday is January 15th.
Correct.
And what do you think he would think about the state, specifically of African American, the state of and plight of African Americans today, if he were alive?
In my opinion?
Yes, sir.
I think he will be somewhat disappointed.
Okay. I
really do believe that he will be disappointed because his vision and his message wasn't what we see now today.
Right.
And I just really believe that if he had to come back now and look at and evaluate where we are, we have not accomplished a lot of things that he set forth that we might have if we go and do what he do in terms of preparation. So he would not be happy, in my opinion.
Mayor, last comment. What would you like to share with the people of Memphis? We're so glad that you're here. What would you like to share with the people of Memphis?
I would like to share the people, go see the movie.
Okay.
Go see the movie. I've seen the movie twice already. I went to one of the ladies in the movie, Miss Amelia Boynton, who's in the movie, 106 years old.
Oh, my goodness.
She invited me to her home in Tuskegee. They showed her the movie in her home with some other friends of hers. And she was elated to see this movie. And she's 106 years old. Mm. And she played that role. There's a young lady, Lorraine, playing Mrs. Boynton. And she is actually from Selma. Mm. And so forth. So that I would say, go out and see the movie for yourself. There's a lot of controversial talk about this or that. It's what is accurate and what is not accurate. But as I've said to people, this is not a documentary. This is a movie. And as a movie, it doesn't have to be factual and exact all the time.
Well, let me just say that I know we're having our premiere here tomorrow night. The Color Girls are presenting it, and they're going to be on in a few moments. But what's going on in Selma? You have a weekend of activities associated? Because, you know, maybe some people might want to drive to Selma for the weekend.
Well, welcome to come. I just got through talking with people at home right now. We're giving out tickets today and tomorrow for people to come see the movie Friday, Saturday, and Sunday in Selma, three times and four times each day. They're around the block right now trying to get there. And it's free in Selma.
Wonderful.
I know you all have a fee. Paramount has made this movie in Selma free to anybody who wants to come.
That's wonderful.
And so we're grateful for that. So if anyone would like to come to Selma and watch the movie, which there will be people from other cities that will come. So we're looking forward to it. And we will be premiering Red Carpet on January 18th.
Ooh, Red Carpet.
Red Carpet. Some of the cast will be coming back. Probably Oprah will be back during that time. But that's on January 18th as we celebrate Martin Luther King's birthday that weekend. So we'll have Red Carpet there in Selma on the 18th.
That's wonderful. Mayor George Evans, the mayor of the great city of Selma, Alabama, welcome. And thank you so much for coming on Dialogue with Deidre. It's such an honor to have you here today.
Deidre, I'll tell you, it's an honor for me to be here. And again, I give hats off to Myron and Mary and Gail
and TaJuan
all who shared their thoughts and ideas and find a way for me to work in my schedule where I could come along with my wife, Jeannie, to be here and be a part of this.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you for bringing the First Lady with
yes,
you.
Yes, thank you.
All right. You're watching Dialogue with Deidre. When we come back, the Colored Girls are in the house, Gale Jones Carson and TaJuan Stout Mitchell. We're going to talk about the premiere tomorrow night, and so excited that the Carter Malone Group and Malone Sullivan Public Strategies are sponsoring the premiere. We'll be back in a moment.
Supporters. Detroit, New York, Los Angeles, inciting large-scale arrests and sympathy marches.
I'm very aware of that, Mr. Hoover.
What I do know is he's nonviolent. What I need to know right now, what's Martin Luther King about to do next?
Mr. President, Dr. King is here.
Mr. President.
In the South, there have been thousands of racially motivated murders.
We need your help.
Dr. King, this thing's just gonna have to wait.
It cannot wait.
You got one big issue, I got 101.
Selma it is.
Here is the next great battle.
Selma's the place, and they ready.
Dr. King!
I tell you, that white boy can hit.
You will not tolerate agitators attempting to orchestrate a disturbance in this state.
It is unacceptable that they use their power to keep us voiceless. Those that have gone before us say no more.
People actually say they're gonna kill our children. They are trying to get inside of your head.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
We build the path as we can, rock by rock.
His cell is probably bugged.
It probably is.
We must march. We must stand up.
You march those people into rural Alabama, it's got to be open season.
May I have a word?
There's no word to be had.
The people. The people. The people. The people. The people. The people.
There are 70 million people watching. These pictures are going around the world.
We must make a massive demonstration.
White, black, and otherwise. Come to Selma.
I heard about the attack of innocent people. I couldn't just stand by.
Looks like an army out there.
This revolution goes on and on. This revolution goes on and on.
My eyes have seen the glory.
What happens when a man stands up, says enough is enough?
Wow, Teller Brown, your drugstore, your drugstore, and your drugstore. Hey, we everyone's drugstore. And we're located at 3333 East Chevy Drive, 794-3690. All medical plans. We support supported living, assisted living. We do it all. And guess what? We even have a $4 plan. Hey, call to ask Dr. Brown about that. I gotta go because she's coming with those boots.
The Carter Malone Group is a full-service public relations agency. Celebrating 10 years of being in business, the Carter Malone Group is located in Midtown Memphis and represents clients across the country. No matter what size your business, if you are interested in promoting your product or service and increasing your market share, contact the firm that can help you meet your goals. The Carter Malone Group. Call 901-278-0881 today.
To be able to go to church and tell pastor or stand up and tell everybody my baby's going to college, my baby got a scholarship, it's the next best thing to dying and going to heaven.
Thing in my family. If you don't finish college, then they don't know you. They do not know you. It would be a very big disappointment.
Okay, so you go to college and you're supposed to be an educated person. Well, first the question is, what does it mean to be an educated person?
The purpose of education is to enlighten a young mind and put them on the path for success.
The function of education is to teach you to handle power. But how can you have power if you don't even have the ability to sustain yourself? We find that the tuition that's being paid is really treated as hush money, because many inside of higher education know that it is not the value that is passed off as being.
I don't feel confident. I'm scared. I'm being truthful. I'm scared out of my wits coming if I don't have a job by then.
Like I said, I think Selma is the biggest legal pimp in America.
Information is power. Education is not power.
People that can get out of that line have tangible, sellable skills in other areas. People who don't have those skills have to stay in the line and hope and pray that they get one of the 10 jobs that they probably won't get. Martin Luther King said it best, there comes a point where silence is betrayal. We've come to that point. When college students are graduating in a recession with hundreds of thousands of dollars of debt and cannot secure employment and are getting $10 an hour jobs, silence is betrayal. What are we being taught in the name of education? We're being taught to do certain things that prepare us for certain jobs. But we're not taught to live free in the realm of our own possibilities.
To ride my bike to get some exercise, just kind of clear my head.
I like to ride because it's really fun for me and my fiance to go ride together.
I started riding my bike as a way to save money on gas.
I like to ride my bike mostly because it's fun and it's good exercise.
That's how I get everywhere. It's how I go to grocery stores, go to work, it's how I go to my friend's house.
Sometimes I just like to not even have a particular destination in mind, just to see different parts of the city.
Just going through the park, you know, you see people, and if you're on your bike, you can smile or say hello.
I own 5 bikes. The green Schwinn is my grandfather's bike, and every time I ride it, and he can be with me where I go.
I'm not burning gas, I'm not polluting the air. And, you know, in a way, it kind of gets me back to the kid in me, which is kind of cool.
To Dialogue with Deidre. I'm your host, Deidre Malone. The colored girls are in the house. Gale Jones Carson, TaJuan Stout Mitchell. Welcome back to Dialogue with Deidre, ladies.
Thank you for having us.
This is a hot ticket.
Yes, it is.
It's a hot movie.
It's a hot movie.
It's a hot movie.
I have to say that you guys have been doing this for a while, and it's your way to give back, and you do such an, I just want to commend you and just thank you for letting the Carter Malone Group and Malone Sullivan Public Strategies be a sponsor of your premiere.
I want to thank you, because when we needed a sponsor, you stepped up and did not hesitate, didn't doubt. You just volunteered. That's what I like.
And I think it adds another dimension to strong women coming together, making something happen, because getting the sponsor is the hardest part for us.
Thank you.
And then, you know, you have so many people who think women can't work together. But if you look all over this country at a lot of things that have been accomplished in this country, it was women working together.
That's
right. You have a few bad eggs, but for the most part, women work well together.
Thank you, ladies. So let's talk about this movie. What are you excited about it?
I'm excited about the timing of it. It's coming out in, you know, in January. The national premiere, national showing release is Friday on January 9th, and our premiere is on the 8th. But what else is so much going on in this country now about injustices, like, you know, Ferguson, New York, and other things that are going on. And I'm just hoping our young people will go out and watch this movie and tie this movie to current history and past history. And I'm just really excited and thankful that they've come out with this movie. And everything I've seen on it, it is excellent. It is an excellent piece of work. The acting is wonderful. The story is wonderful. And I'm hoping that we, even people who can't come to Thursday night's premiere, which is Thursday, 6 p.m. at the Paradiso on Mendenhall and Poplar. If you can't come to the premiere, please, please, I beg you to go to the movie this week and watch this. We show up for Tyler. I love Tyler Perry. I don't miss his movie, but we need to show up and show out for this movie.
Well, I'm excited about it all. I'm excited about the fact that it celebrates our history and it tells our story, but it also motivates us because I'm one who believes the struggle is not over, and we cannot rest in our laurels. We must realize that it took organization, foot soldiers, as well as leaders to get us where we are. And sometimes I feel that there's a void in that today. And so if we get a chance to see the movie, and we're gonna do something different. We're gonna have two theaters, an under 30 theater
For young folks.
For young people, and we'll have a panel discussion after the movie for young people so they can think and re-energize and get ready for the next 50 years. And we will have a theater for those over 30. Gail will be in the under 30.
Yes, I'm sure.
Yes.
But I'll be in.
I really am curious to know how our young people are perceiving civil rights. What's in their minds? What has actually been passed on to them and what's sticking? I want to know what they're thinking.
And I'll be in the over 30 welcoming the crowd and introducing our legends and trying to inspire legends on our panel discussion to make room for youth.
Exactly.
Because I don't say step aside. And sometimes I think that we get in a tussle because young people want you to die off.
They do. They want you to die off, some of them.
Now, I'm 62, but I'm not dead yet. Right. So, well, I am going to make room.
But mentor.
And everybody, all generations need to work together because we all bring something to the table. And we all working together can make things better. And we can move to the next step. And it's not pushing anybody to the side. It's not keeping the young people down. It's everybody working together.
Well, and their perspective is a good perspective. Mm-hmm. And it's just different sometimes from our perspective, but it adds to it. Yeah. And so working together, we can make some things happen, right, ladies?
That's
yes,
right.
Yes, and I do want to mention the theater of 30 and older, the panel discussion is going to be led by our civil rights activist, our own Judge DeArmond Bailey. Mm. I know is going to do an excellent job, and we're going to have civil rights activists and leaders on that panel. And then, as Tuan mentioned on the other panel, we're going to have teenagers on there who have traveled every summer to spend time 4 to 5 days every summer to spend time with civil rights leaders. So they're going to share their experiences, and they're going to talk all about the Selma movie and civil rights in our country today.
That's wonderful.
And another good point, I'm excited about the fact that I think we're going to raise a lot of money for two wonderful nonprofit organizations. Dr. King was really all about civil rights, but he was also about economic rights.
Yes.
And he believed, he dearly believed that we have two classes in America and a struggling poor.
That's right.
And that's why he wanted to lead a poor people's march.
That's right.
And so when I think of MIFAS Plus One program, it gives me and others an opportunity to help somebody else.
It's that helping hand.
That's right.
And what I need to point out is not giving out. It's helping people come up.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
We are helping people. These are families who are in dire critical need. And one of the things that we have learned with Plus One Giving is those people who are helped by Plus One, they don't get their services cut off again. They are long-term utility users without any problems.
Okay.
Plus One, MIFA helps them not just with a contribution, but anything else they need. They work with them on other social services. MIFA has 9 really strong programs that help those in need in Memphis and Shelby County. So that is a passion of mine to help these people who have utility assistance problems.
And the April 4 Foundation, they have a program called Footsteps. Mm. And Footsteps, that program allows children an opportunity to dialogue with civil rights leaders, walk through some of their experiences, travel afar to see places they probably never have seen but read about. And hopefully it will ignite an energy in those young people to also become leaders in civil rights. But if not, they will always be torchbearers.
And Reverend Johnson Salisbury.
That's right. He does an excellent job with
of April 4th. This is wonderful, ladies. Okay, do you still have any tickets? Because I'm just like, if people need some tickets.
I'm scared to count because I really think we have almost sold.
Well, we're going to have two theaters. So, I mean, if you haven't gotten your tickets, just show up at the theater and come to our table. And we're going to try to get you in there. But I do have some tickets left.
But you need to come early.
You better come early.
We're starting at 6. The movie will start at 6:30 because we want the discussion after the movie.
Exactly. Okay.
So if you do not have a ticket and trying to get in at the door, I would suggest you be there by 5:45, 5:30.
Okay. Exactly, 5:30.
Because I've got a funny feeling this is you're going to pack both theaters, yes. And it's going to be sold out.
I'm hoping so because, like I said earlier, even if people can't come to the premiere, please go this weekend. This is a powerful movie. We need to continue to remind people of the injustices that have happened in this country in hopes that we won't continue these injustices.
That's right.
You got to remember history. And some young folks, they don't want to relate to it. They don't know it. But then when they get out here in the real world and they get slapped with some of this stuff, then they take a different stance. But don't wait till you get slapped. Just know and understand what has happened and that it can also repeat
and
itself.
And this is not just about Selma's story. A lot of that is New York stories,
mm-hmm. Exactly. Memphis
Ferguson's
story.
Mm-hmm. But most of all, Memphis' story, because we got a story of our own, and we have a story right now.
Mm-hmm. Lady.
We constantly in this country have to deal
with stuff,
and it's just about how you deal with it and everyone working together, coming to the table, making sure that everything's okay.
Gale Jones Carson, TaJuan Stout Mitchell. Ladies, thank you so
thank
much
you.
For coming
thank
on and sharing. And I'll be in the house. You already
thank
know.
Thank you. Thank you.
Right.
High five.
Thank you. All right.
You have been watching Dialogue with Deidre. I'm your host, Deidre Malone. I hope you've had an opportunity to watch the whole show, and I hope you enjoyed it. We'll see you again on Monday at noon.